What I like to do is to talk a bit about how we can really interface and on one side high power computing, material science, using workflows. And I realized so workflows are something rather new, and they essentially came together because with increasing compute power, we need really new tools. So before everything was monolithic, we could have a single job, a single run, and we could make a nice paper out of it. So nowadays we need something like 10,000, 100,000 jobs, and that means so we have really to change the way how we are approaching the material science questions. And what I like to do is to give kind of an overview, so what techniques are available, and of course I will focus a bit more than on our solution, Pyron, but of course, so there are many more approaches, and I'm really looking forward about the exciting developments and results and from the other contributions. So let me start a bit, why do we need in material science workflows and what are the challenges? And I think I don't have really to explain this type of picture. You have probably seen hundreds of different variants. But the main point in terms of workflows is that at every scale that I have to scan then my material, I have to describe my material, I have very different tools. So if I think about DFT on the lowest level, then something like empirical potentials, dislocation dynamics, going all the way up then here to the macro scale, where finite element programs, they are not really meant to work together. So they have very different input, very different output formats. So there is no interoperability with them. And that means we definitely have, in terms then of material science, a big issue in bringing together then these type of different codes. And let me be a bit more specific. So what is my personal perspective? And in our department, what we really try to describe is more on the atomic side, the different aspects and the different responses a material can have. And response with respect then to thermodynamic quantities, so what happens to my material if I apply then certain temperatures, pressures, chemical potentials, but not just restricted to it. Or the electrochemical, and this is really where Mira Todorova is then a specialist in looking into it, but of course also into mechanical properties. And again, this multi-scale approach comes in there. It's not just the clean material, so the chemically pure, defect-free crystal, which is interesting. What we really have to understand and to look, what is the interaction then between these type of defects, which we can have at the surface, which we can have then in the bulk system, with these type of quantities, and particularly, of course, then also with respect to chemical elements that we have in there. And the main goal, if we really want to do virtual material design, is to actually be able to have methods that predict what and how do then the thermodynamic, electrochemical, mechanical properties of the system change as functions then of these properties. And what do we have to do in order to understand this? We have on one side to perform then statistical ensembles. And if we are looking at the most fundamental place, what we are having then is vibrational, chemical, magnetic, electronic contributions. And we see all these contributions are on the identical scale. So this is really the electronic structure, atomic scale. And we have to essentially try to couple them and go then over the large configuration spaces in order to take them into account. And typically it's not just sufficient to adiabatically describe them, but we have also to include then coupling. So the next level of complexity is if you are going then to chemical complexity. And there are recent very interesting developments by going away then from materials, alloy systems that have just one single principal element like iron or nickel, but really having then multiple principal elements, so the high entropy alloys. And if you look then into statistical sampling of these, so one has then a huge number then also next to the electronic and thermal averages, we have also to sample over a huge number then of local chemical averages. And in the end, also this is not really sufficient if I really want to describe then a typical realistic alloy system. I have also to take into account then structural complexity. So all these averages I described before are not just restricted then to the perfect bulk system. We have to do it also then for grain boundaries, so for two-dimensional defects, one-dimensional defects, surfaces, etc., and essentially taking then averages, thermodynamic averages, over then these macro states like chemical composition, temperature, magnetism, etc. And how can we do this and what are the challenges? Essentially, if you're looking then at the degrees of freedom we are having, so in order to describe the atomic position, this would be a bit then the vibrational degrees of freedom. So I have then 3n coordinates for the atoms, my chemical species, so I have then the number of elements in the periodic table, I have then magnetic contributions, electronic contributions. And just making a very simple estimate, you immediately see so that you are getting enormous number of configurations in there, which are in a brute force approach, not really possible. And what one really has to do is to have then some kind of dimensionality reduction. And that means so we are needing then mass and machine learning concepts. And I think that's why we are all together here. So how really to do it? But in order to apply them, we really have to bring in together then very different methods and techniques. And just to outline and really show then the challenges. So in order really to be able to employ and utilize then this huge configuration space in order to come up with new materials, what we really have to be able is to navigate then efficiently in these high-dimensional materials configuration spaces. And what are the practical issues then with this? And what I show here, and I don't really want to discuss then all the different aspects and equations, but this is one of the early examples. So we really were able to get this milli-EV accuracy for materials all the way up then to the melting temperature. And what is shown here, this is the thermal expansion coefficient of bulk FCC aluminum versus temperature. The dots are experiment. These are the two main exchange correlation functionals. And you can see, so one can, even up to the melting temperature, really get a very accurate result. And if we would like to do this directly, we would need then something like 10 to 7, so 10 millions, 100 millions DFT calculations. No way really to do it. So via dimensionality reduction, we were able to put a lot of extra effort, of this mathematical effort, then on cheaper methods. But that really means so we have to couple then different approaches. So in order to describe the vibrations on the more approximate level, we need harmonic vibrations. So we use phonopi for it. So in order to describe then spin and spin Monte Carlo, we're using then the Elps code. So for the thermodynamic quantities, for the unharmonic vibrations, you can see there are very different techniques. And we even have to couple something like atomistic tools like LAMMPS and WASP in order to perform thermodynamic integration of free energy perturbation. So you see, so nowadays it's not really possible to stick then to your favorite type, let's say, of code, something like DFT or empirical potentials, but we really have to come and bring these things together. And that really means so for high throughput, and this is then just, let's say, for a single system going up to high temperatures, if you really want to do high throughput material screening in this huge configuration space, you have really to enable then a connection to the very powerful scientific libraries that we're having then in the Python universe. So let me give a second example, and this is something Jan will later talk about in much greater detail. So this is just a very rough sketch of a workflow we developed in order to describe melting points. So what is really the melting temperature? And the idea and the approach used here is then the so-called interface method. So you are just monitoring at a given temperature whether your solid will increase, so then you are below the melting temperature, or whether your liquid will increase in volume, and then you know so that you are above the melting temperature. And you have then to do a lot of, let's say, elementary steps. So you have to construct first your solid, your liquid, bring them together, form then this interface. You need some monitoring. But it turns out life is never really so simple. So you need then also something like void detectors, because if you go to high temperatures, your system can form then bubbles in the system. You need a very accurate detector for this interface. But everything has really to go then into this type of algorithm to really have then some kind of autonomous algorithm so that is capable to detect whether the things are failing or not. And once you're able to do it, you can really do exciting physics by looking then at a large number then of different potentials in order to detect and identify what are then underlying physical relations. And again, this is something Jan will talk in much more detail. Let me give a third and final example for workflows, and that's from a recent science paper. We were looking for alloy discovery for high entropy alloys. And this shows a bit then the complexity on today's needs in order really to combine a large search then in configuration space with experiments, with machine learning, including then DFT calculations to get the physical properties. And just what one could achieve, or what we could achieve here, is this is a thermal expansion coefficient for invar alloys. You want really to get as close as possible to zero. That was using empirical methods in the high entropy alloys. This is what we could achieve then with this type of workflow-based approach. So it really makes a difference, and I think we all agree so that workflows are something which is absolutely necessary in order to utilize then the big potential and the big opportunities that we are having to discover then new alloys. So what is and what enabled really these recent breakthroughs? And this is essentially that we can describe and handle then complex simulation protocols on high-performance computers. And in the past, it was, as I mentioned in the beginning, it was really sufficient to look then into monolithic program code. So like you have then a big, let's say, code like WASP or so, but also finite element approaches. If you think about astrophysicists, so describing then something like, let's say, a black hole, et cetera, you need a single program. What we are needing now more, and you could really see, and therefore I was showing these examples, so that we need in order to get a good description to really navigate then this huge configuration space. You need 10,000, 100,000, millions then of different calculations, and they have to be handled automatically. I think we all agree there's no way that a human manually can handle then these type of things. So what is really a workflow? And I tried really to break it down to the fundamentals. So on the most elementary basic level, what we would like is to couple then two codes. I have code one, I have code two, and as input, I could have either file-based format, or I could have then some data, could be simple floats, could come from a database, whatever. And then we would like to transfer this output, or let's say get it into the code one. It's like a functional object, and this produces then some output. And we would like to feed in then this output into the next code, get again output, and ideally we would have then in a database the input, the workflow, and the output. So this is the ideal picture. So let's be a bit more concrete and look what happens then if we go into material science. So what are the challenges that we are facing there? So just taking, let's say, two codes which have been discussed also here in this IPAM workshop, a lot is on one side LAMMPS, on the other side WASP. So one is then empirical potentials, the other DFT, and I mentioned already for thermodynamic integration, for quick screening, relaxation, you would really like in workflows to couple them. So if you take the LAMMPS output, there's no way really to bring it then into the WASP input. So you need then some parsers, you need then some extra routines to do it. And I think this is also very different what we have then in the bioinformatics community. So in the bioinformatics community, so they have really many tools, they have fixed file formats, so therefore it's pretty easy in most cases, you can use a simple Unix pipe in order to go from one code to the other. I think this is something which in most cases doesn't work then in material science. Our codes are simply too diverse, too different, too heterogeneous. So we have a lack of interoperability. What we also don't have is so that these outputs come out then as a normal file format. But there is no direct way so that this automatically goes then into the database. So we have very powerful database systems, and Claudia is then here with Nomad, and she will talk a lot about it. But typically it means we have to do it after we have produced it, so there must be a manual transport then into the database. And I think it would be nice really to ensure already from the workflow, so that the entire workflow is not only the input-output, but also the workflow, which is going directly then into the database. and that's of course directly related then to the lack of interoperability. We have code-specific input, we have code-specific output. This means we need, or the user needs, a lot of technical expertise because they have to know about all the technical details of the individual codes. So somebody knowing how to work then with LAMMPS would still have a long learning curve in order to go then into WASP, because they have to know then all the different technical, let's say, how the input and everything is done. And in this way, it's important really to think also about kind, let's say, of generic and abstraction layer, so which makes atomistic codes look alike. And one example, so where this has been done very successful, are these scientific libraries that we are having then in Python available. So and I just took one example. So if you look, let's say, for optimization, so that's what is coming up. And what I really like to emphasize, to look a bit how this minimize is actually implemented and what type of features it offers. So on one side, the input parameters are just standard Python. So this is a Python function that is defined. X0 is a normal NumPy array, so data type. So it works out of the box then with the Python universe. What's also super nice is so that here I can provide the method, the optimization method I want to have. So typically it was so that I have in Fortran then one optimization method. This was one code block with different input, different output. Then for another method, very different. Also what they managed really to do is to get something which I would call then generic input. So if you want really to have a certain accuracy, a certain convergence. So these parameters are identical whatever method you are using. I think this makes it much more powerful and much more user-friendly in order really to be able also for newcomers to get in there. And the same applies also for the output. So this is complete generic output. Everybody understands it. And the same also if I look, let's see, at my results, I can directly see it. And it's, as I mentioned before, fully embedded in Python. So what would we like if we translate this example to material science simulations? So what we would like is that we have now a minimization. We provide then a structure. We provide then the selection of the method by WASP, and I can put in here LAMMPS or whatever. And I can provide here then generic input. This would be the convergence criterion for the energy, for the forces, etc. And what I, of course, would like is then something like my result, output, energy tot, and then I'm getting the total energy. If I say here forces, then I want to get my forces. And again, fully embedded in Python. So we want actually to have more than what just NumPy and SciPy is offering. So we want also to have then an automated upload of input and selected output to database and storage. So that's what I mentioned before. We would like to have an upscaling to HPC, and particularly in this workshop, we are interested, of course, then in going really to exascale computing in order to bring up the full power that we have nowadays available. And that means so we want to have a job management which you don't really find then in NumPy or SciPy. And we want, of course, in order to make it easy for users to have full integration into the Jupyter universe so that you can visualize complete data structures, such as, for instance, then atomic trajectories. So our approach, and again, I said in the beginning, so there are various approaches to do it and various platforms for workflows, is Pyren. And Pyren is essentially a combination of Python, so that's the programming language we were using for it. And then the name of our institute, and Pink did a great job in pronouncing correctly, then the Eisenforschung. And if you literally translate then Eisenforschung, so this would be Iron, so this is then here Pyren as a combination of these two words. And what Pyren is essentially doing, so it's integrating then all these different tools that I was mentioning already, and it allows then on the same, inside the same framework, and therefore we call it then an integrated development environment, because people, in order to develop, implement, test, and run and upscale really to high-performance computing, they never have really to leave then this type of environment. This allows, and I will give then a few examples, to run really the simulation, to perform then the data analysis, and lately we included all the experiments. And it has already then quite some outreach in order to go then to big initiatives, which I will mention also later a bit. So what are the key concepts of PIRON? And these are then the so-called PIRON objects. And the main idea is to make it really easy and to shield the user from the complexity of the underlying codes, to have then an identical generic look and feel. So if I'm working then on LAMMPS and I have my PIRON layer around it, so then I can just see job structure, job input, job output energy. And this structure, which is going in and out then of this PIRON layer and is translated then into LAMMPS, is identical to the one we have then for WASP or any type of other atomistic code. And in this way, I can directly set this as output, this as input, would work then out of the box. And it's also for the user super easy because they know exactly where really to find the input, where to find then a specific output, and how really to do the job management. So just seeing then job dot run. What this PIRON layer, what these PIRON objects also immediately allow to do is to connect then to the resources and to the storage. The storage here is kind of a combination of an SQL database in order to really be super fast, but containing only the minimal information, and HDF5 in order to really store also then the big objects like trajectories, which can be megabytes or even gigabytes of size. So let me be a bit more concrete, because I realize if I'm seeing these type of very schematic plots, it looks nice, but it's really hard to see. So what is really behind it? And I would like to come back then here to this melting point example, so and showing then a very simple schematic workflow. So what we have to do is first, as I mentioned, construct then a structure. So we have to go to finite temperature closely below then the melting temperature for the solid part. We have to go then above the melting temperature to melt it. We have to combine these two. So now we have the solid-liquid interface, and we can essentially directly monitor whether the interface is moving to the right. So then the temperature would be too high. If it's moving to the left, the temperature is too low. And in this way, we can very accurately determine then the melting temperature. And a simple schematic workflow looks like this: structure, relaxation, solid melting, blah, blah. So how can we realize this type of workflow then in PIRON? So, and this is directly then implemented in a Jupyter notebook, so therefore we can nicely structure it, we can provide then direct information for further users, so we can give a title, subtitles, etc. What is important is all you really have to import for PIRON is this project. So the project is a central key object, and from this you can derive via auto-completion, so you don't have really to remember all these tools and the different commands. Everything can be derived directly from this project. And the first thing is to give it a name, and the name is like having then a directory where all the data and the files, etc., are put then in there. So the next thing is let's create a structure. And the example was showing here then FCC aluminum with vacancy, and then I decided let's, in order to better see it, put an aluminum in there. So all we have to do is just PR, so this project, then create, and again, it's Python, Jupyter notebook, auto-completion, so you just type create dot, and then it will show you a couple of possibilities that you're having, so then you can go to structure, bulk, and then you define the element, whether you want to have a cubic crystal shape, or whether you have then the primitive cell. You see, you want to have then a 3x3x3 cell, you replace then this atom by aluminum, that's this gray one, you can plot it, so everything in the same Jupyter notebook, people can directly see what they're doing, really building up fully interactively in this type of workflow. What we can do next is really running then an MD simulation. So the first thing is creating then a job, and you see already the pattern. So now instead of having create.structure, we see create.job, dot, and then you will get a variety then of different jobs. So you can have LAMMPS, you can have WASP, whatever. And then you just provide a name then for this one. And that's something which is important for PIRON. Every object has a unique name. So it's like a URL path. So you really want to make sure so that the project and this name in this project is unique, because then you can very quickly re-identify it, and you can, like with a URL path, even if you have then a huge repository, very easily get exactly your object. So then we have to assign then the structure. So we take our Kappa object we created in the previous slide. And then one of the nice things is you don't have really to leave this notebook in order to see what potentials are available. So you see just something like list potentials, and I've picked only the first 10 in order not really to do it. I think for these systems, probably there are something like a few dozen, 50 or so potentials. Then you can choose your favorite ones. I've picked then this one. And again, so we want to do now molecular dynamics. So we can see temperature, gives then the temperature, number of ionic steps. And again, this is not, let's say, the native LEMS input that we're having in here. So this is really completely generic. And if I wanted now to go to a VASP calculation, all I would essentially have to do is replace this by VASP. For VASP, typically one has default parameters. It's essentially via the exchange correlation functional. So you can even skip then this line and this line. And then by default, you would get then the corresponding DFT calculation. And then you see just run. And in this case, I wanted, let's say, that the job is not stored in the database, but that it's if I run it again, so therefore this one. But that's it. And this run command is really super powerful, because what it's doing essentially, it's translating the generic input into the LEMS-specific input. It's creating a working directory. It's putting or running then the calculation. It's collecting the output, translating it back then into the generic output, and bringing this then into the database so that it's accessible then for later usages. And just to show, so what is happening behind the scenes? So now I can see reload this. So the objects, the entire object was written then into the database, and I can now via peer load, and this is the job name, and therefore I said it really has to be kind of, let's say, in this project a unique name. So that's this one, and typically it's a good idea to have a marker which reminds you what you were doing here, and 700 Kelvin temperature is important one. Now I can see input.control. And now all the LEMS users seeing immediately, this is what comes out from the generic format. So this is how the translated LEMS input file looks like. So I can have a direct look. If I want to change anything in here, I can just make then a few lines extra, make then changes in this specific input file, so for the experts. But normally, hopefully it's sufficient to work then on the generic level. And then, because everything is really in the database, not just the energies, et cetera, but and really written automatically, so what one can do is really to inspect then, so what is happening. And the example I've chosen here is, let's look at the x-coordinates as function of MD steps. And we see it's pretty boring, so we see just, let's say, the normal oscillations of our atoms, and we immediately see no diffusion event. It's far, far away from any type of melting. So what we can do now super easily, because it really has this type of NumPy SciPy structure. So we can now say, let's now run a series of jobs from 700 to 1800 Kelvin in 100 Kelvin steps. And this is standard Python that we are having here. And then all I do is now, in order to have a nice name, so that I put then the temperature into the job name, I assign again then the Kappa to it, potential we know already, and that's it. And the main difference is so that I have now the temperature as a variable. And then I say job run. And what you see is, so I'm getting then all these jobs. I'm getting then the database ID for each of these. And you see something interesting here. So this 700 Kelvin job, we run already. So it knows that it is already there. Then rather rerunning it, it's just automatically loading it from the database. It's like caching then the data, and in this way it makes it super performant. If you want later to redo something, it knows what you did already, and it's only doing what really has to be done then in the next step. So how to analyze it? And again, so that's a nice thing, because we have everything in a super structured database. What we can do is to create what we call then a parent table. And the parent table can be created again, PR create table. So you see exactly the same pattern. And then we can add some predefined things like get volume, get energy tot per atom, get job name. So this is coming again via auto-completion. But we have also and can also define our own parameters. Because we have, let's say, the full data in there. So we have the trajectories. We can do something like getting the displacement out of it. So really, what is the average displacement from the wiggle set we have seen before? So how and what is then the average, so essentially the mean displacement? And again, this is just standard Python, so that we have then NumPy mean, so we take the average, we take the norm, so of the axis 3, because we have x, y, z axis, we take the initial position minus the final one, and this is already all we need in order to get the displacement. And you see again, because we have now this type of generic output, we have output generic unwrap position, so we want to use the unwrap position, not really to have, let's say, this wrap around things then due to periodic boundary conditions. That's it. And you can also really do, let's say, then standard Python so to extract the temperature. That was showing this only as an example. You could also get it directly, but really showing so you can now get from the job name, because we coded there the temperature, you can easily get it out. And then essentially we define this table, we say again then run. This is what you're seeing. You really see it essentially doesn't take any time to browse in the database, and that's what we are getting. So this would be then the data frame. I sorted it by temperature in order to have it nice looking. And then you are seeing here the job name, the total energy, the volume, temperature, our displacement. And this is a standard Pandas data frame. So and this is, of course, the basis for any type of machine learning. And you can immediately see that's what I can do then for 10,000, 100,000 jobs. So super easy to set up, super easy to extract then the data. And we are getting then this pretty powerful Pandas data frame. Just to show us a little bit, let's say, of physics, so in order to analyze then this average displacement. So all I have really to do is now my Pandas data frame, getting the temperature, getting the displacement, and then I'm seeing it goes pretty steady. And then something like Lindemann jumps in, so the vibrations are getting too large, and then I'm seeing it goes exponentially. So this is then really viscosity and diffusion that sets in. So I can immediately see, so in this region here, my melting sets in. But we can do more. So we can now, because everything is in this database automatically without the user really being manually forced to do it. So we can analyze the structure. So we can see job MD, get structure. Let's take the last step. And then we make again a plot and you see it now looks really like we would expect, like a liquid. And we can also super easily, because we have all these features, all the data available, look then at a pair correlation function. Again, just standard NumPy. And we load then, let's say, for each temperature, the corresponding job. We take then the nearest neighbor environment, and we have to go rather high in the number of neighbors that we want to include. We get then a histogram just of the neighbors, the distances, so what is and then we flatten it in order to get a one-dimensional array. And then we are getting for 700 Kelvin, so we see the sharper peaks, and for 1,000, what is the other number, then 1,700 Kelvin, so we see it's really more like a liquid. We still see some local ordering. But again, so you can really bring the two worlds, then our material science simulation codes with NumPy, SciPy together and really have at the fingertip then this type of information. So in this way, what I hope to have shown a bit is so that we can really go a long way forward in order to make and combine then the features that we're having then in something like NumPy and SciPy, so in order to or to work then these type of material science simulation codes. So we can really plug in our structure, method WASP, so I showed already so that we can use this via create job.wasp. We have then these generic input, generic output. So what I have not shown is essentially this upscaling to HPC and the message selection via single parameter. And this is what I want to show now. So we can now really go, and you could really see so how we are setting up then these workflows. So we are starting completely interactively, so one can see how the structure, every single command. And all, if we want really to go then to high performance computing, all we have essentially to do is to look then what are the queues available, for instance, in our system. So I can see so how many cores do I have available, what is the runtime limit, etc. So that's our specific cluster, of course. And then I can define so how many cores should really this job get, and what is then the server queue. That's all you have to do in order to really make from the single calculation the upscaling to high performance computing. So the second thing is so then method selection by a single parameter. So again, I think this is one of the really nice features. So we can now directly go then over different atomistic codes. And you see, so I can now really connect something like empirical potentials with DFT codes and Sphinx is then our own then in-house DFT code. And of course, this is implemented then in here. And what we have to do is just job type. So this is then the code. I have to provide a name and I use just then here the job type. I sign then aluminum again, then I run it. And then I can take this output directly, which I'm getting from, let's say, LAMS and put it into VASP without really having to do any conversion, etc. So this is something which becomes possible. And with this, one can really do then this type of advanced complex simulations. And again, so Jan is talking more than about going then to the melting point. So I thought, because this is a workshop then about workflows, I should not only show, let's say, the nice technical features, because I really have to say, so I was expecting a lot of challenges on the technical side. What I didn't was expecting, we really started with this workflow, let's say Pyron, something like 10 years ago. So we were pretty early on. And this was really sociological issues, challenges. Because my naive expectation is if, and probably I'm too much doing thermodynamics, so if somebody is sitting here and you provide now something which has a ground state here, so really a better tool, so then automatically there is no barrier and people will moving in there. My experience is this is never going to happen. And workflows are something super individual. So everybody, of course, in particular the experts, they have their own workflow. And of course, so we all run, let's say, through this phase. So I, at some point, also wanted to have really with grep and org and parsing it. And that's it. So why really needing something which is, yeah, then forcing me in a certain corset? And the way I realized it, when I asked, let's say, in my group, and people told me, oh, I'm writing a parser in order to get the free energy, and I asked the next one, so what are you doing at the moment? I'm writing a parser and a parser. And then I realized, so some, let's say, it took really weeks or so to identify this was not really the free energy I wanted to have from VARs, but it was the other one, so with the electronic free energy. And you see, so there are a lot, let's say, of problematic things. And the other thing I learned is, so we had these complex workflows. And it took more than a year for a newcomer really to get acquainted then with all the different tools. So in this way, so this was for me the starting point really is to see, so we have really to go then in there. And we all know about, let's say, activation barriers and to overcome them. So one would be temperature, and you could of course make a lot of heat. I think this is not what is going to work. So I don't really want, let's say, to pressure people to use it, because then they don't like it and it's not really improving it. So what, let's say, were our strategies? And it was really, so with Jan, I don't know how many meetings we had then, probably every day or so. And I think Jan was already then quite often saying, so it's not, yeah, really, people are not using it. And we had then really to come up then with several strategies. And what really was our point is really make it as user-friendly as possible. So don't really blame the user, so that the user is not clever enough or whatever. make your tools really easier. And the other thing is bottom-up development. So don't believe so that you know from top-down so what the user wants to have. Talk to the user, see what is really necessary, and then you are getting something which is needed. What we also realize, so the developers should actually use then also the code, and they should really be familiar. Only then they know what is really and actually needed. And of course, it's about interaction, and therefore I'm really so excited having then again then here these type of IPAM workshops and meetings, because I think this was really one of the most important things. So really organizing weekly meetings in order to bring people together, organizing then conferences also for external people in order to do it. What we came up then were these hackathons, so really bringing small groups of people together and let them do then some coding. And you will really see it's not only good for the code, it's also really bringing the team together. So it's a great team building activity. And of course, typically thing, documentation examples, what also was important, killer applications. So you want to have something in the scheme everybody would like to have, but which otherwise would be very hard. And we had then a very clever structure relaxation algorithm from Christoph Reisold, which was implemented here, which was working for Sphinx, but not really for WASP. And with Python, it was possible to use it. And then the CPU time came down from, let's say, something like several weeks to a few days. And that's, of course, a big incentive for people to go there and make then use of it. And this way, so we tried, let's say, various things, and many things really were needed in order to bring it. And you can also see everybody is different or so. So you don't get with the same measures all people, so you really need then kind of a spectrum of different things. And I mentioned already, so these interactive workshops we had with Ralf Drautz, several very nice ones, and I'm pretty sure so Ralf is talking more about then the machine learning potentials, how workflows can really help. And we could really also during Corona really make almost within, let's say, a few weeks organization time, big workshops, so where we had then provided cloud computing so that everybody had, let's say, the same environment. The presentations, everything are available then on the Pyron website. So Pyron was used then and is used as a teaching platform, so to make then a much more interactive curriculum then for material science. And also we are using it in the department really for hackathons, but also a journal club. So journal club doesn't mean so that we are looking into a paper, but we want really to reprogram it. And it's working because you have really this high language, so that within 2-3 hours, of course, you cannot really reproduce the entire paper, but you are getting already a glimpse. So what are the techniques? What is the problem? And what we are using it also in order to provide, let's say, much better access to our papers. So the idea is so that for a paper, one should also have then a Jupyter notebook, which is not a static object, but which is running out of the box. It's typically implemented in MyBinder, so that all you need is a browser. Then you type in this web page, the browser opens, and then you can directly start with a working, fully functional workflow in order to run then these type of things. I think this is something which is helping the community and, of course, also ourselves in order to get a certain visibility than for these type of publications. So Pyron, and very briefly, I mentioned it already, was also a nucleus then for us in order to initiate and enter then large-scale networks. And one of the examples I want to discuss here is this Material Digital. So this is essentially digitalization materials. And this is funded by the German Ministry for Science and Education. And the idea is essentially to provide a material data space for industry. So that really the different companies can interact and exchange their data. And you immediately see then, of course, data security. So a company never really would like to have then a central server. You have to decentralize it, make sure so that this is really staying then in there. And the main vision is then really to provide then decentralized, and decentralized, I think, is really the key word in order to have same standards for data, data processing, and workflows then in there. And the workflows we are using at the moment in there and which are supported is Pyren and SimStack. So that's from the Qt, more GUI-based workflow. So then another big initiative which is related to Material Digital, but it's more on the academic side. So there is this big NFDI initiative in Germany. So that's the National Data Infrastructure. And this is funded over 10 years with 800 million euro. So that's really big chunk of money. And of course, so it's distributed, if you really boil it down then to the individual consortia, it's smaller, but nevertheless, so this is related then to academia, and Claudia will see much more than with the Nomad project and for the physics community to go in there. But workflows are also a central part then in material science and engineering, and Pyren is again then here a central part then in this consortium for the engineering material science. So just to give a glimpse or so, so how typically things play together. So we are starting then with a model. I discussed already the project, generic input, simulation code. So if we have, for instance, a design problem, like finding ways, alloying impurities in order, or alloying elements in order to make magnesium, which is normally brittle, to make it ductile. That's one of our prime examples of where we really managed using, let's say, these type of approaches to help then engineering a complete new class of ductile materials. So we can set up then, make then the high throughput, we can use then the different codes that we really need to combine them, that's what I showed. We can then do all the nice analysis in the Python universe, and we are connecting directly then to databases. So everything really comes together in order to do then these type of approaches. So I wanted very briefly to discuss some next steps, because this was also partly born then from several of the discussions. And one of the things is so that we are moving now also towards more visual scripting GUI, because we realize, so if you go then to people in industry and also with experimentalists, so they are sometimes a bit scared about Python, because everything which is having ASCII characters looks to them like one has really to know then programming. And again, it's about reducing then these barriers, and we have the feeling so having then this type of more graphical approach, where you can again then really define, let's say, LEMS, you have then your structure object. So what is really behind the scenes is again then Pyren. But it looks much scarier than having, let's say, these type of programmatic things then in there. And what we also realized, so this really helps us to make, let's say, a more abstract understanding about these Pyren objects and making them into the next level to really, on one side, abstract them even more. And also really to think about then the task managers. And that's again something we are discussing then here at this IPAM meeting then a lot. So how really to getting then the task manager, which we need then in order to go to exascale computing, how to get them efficiently in there. And I'm really looking forward, let's say, to these types then of discussions in the forthcoming weeks. So I think my time is almost over, so I wanted to give a few examples then about what we can essentially do with it. I mentioned already then here alloy design. So Mira has a very nice poster outside then about what one can do with workflows in terms then of corrosion, of electrochemistry. So if you're interested more in this, so contact Mira. And of course, so this again are just very few examples, so what became possible. So you can go then into more nanoscience, so nanoaerogels were one example, magnetic materials, high entropy alloys, I mentioned already the INVAR alloys. So it's really in order to explore, to make use then of this huge configuration space, that's what we can do. And in order to make pink not jumping up or so, so I jump then over all these different applications and I go directly towards then the conclusion, which I think I can keep pretty short. I think at this meeting, so which is about workflows, I don't have to convince anybody that workflows are super timely. We need them, but they're also a big challenge. So our approach, and again, so I really want really to be specific. I'm not saying so Pion is the only thing. It's our approach. I know best about it, and therefore all the examples we're done with it is in Pion. And what I always find important, it's not enough to just show that we have nice workflows. We need applications, so we have really to convince the community or so, so that this is really the next step, so that we can actually utilize it, come up then with something which is helpful then also for the materials designers, for engineers. And I think this is a great opportunity that we are having. And with this, I really like to thank the people, so in particular the department at the Max Planck Institute here for and the Department of Computational Materials Design, and particularly so Jan, so and he will much more and really go dive much deeper then into the technicalities. So Fritz was the one who did then here and supervised then also all these high entropy activities. And Tilman Hickel, so he's really pushing forwards and these large networks about NFDI and Material Digital. And of course, so all the developers, contributors to Pyron, and of course, then all the funding agencies, so who provided the money to do this really fun part. So this is, I'm at the end. Thank you very much.